Welcome back, Deep Review TV viewers. Chris Nichols here. And no, we're not doing another monochrome video. Calgary is just that devoid of color right now. A gray flat day to do some shots. But we are going to play with the new Tamron 70-300 RXD version 3. Now, I got to admit, I'm really happy to play with this lens because a 70-300 is everybody's second lens, especially in the days of SLRs. And sadly, very few manufacturers are actually making 70-300s anymore. It's become quite a rarity. So to have this back in my hands, it's just comfortable. It's like macaroni and cheese, or if you're out of the UK, it's like beans on toast, or I don't know. Mabo tofu for the Asians. I mean, pick whatever comfort food you want for your culture. This is my comfort food today. I'm gonna shoot and hopefully get some stuff in this gray light. Now, there's a lot of talk about how lightweight and compact this lens is, and it certainly is. It's just, you know, a 70-300 has always been fairly compact and lightweight, and keep in mind that when you extend it, it still does take up quite a bit of space. It does only weigh, though, 545 grams. That's like a quarter of a noct, or roughly the weight of an American silver dollar. So yes, it doesn't add a lot of weight to the camera. That's why we're using it with the Sony A7C. It's a nice compact pairing with a lightweight camera like this. It's also good that we've got IBIS in the A7C, because honestly, we don't have any image stabilization in the Tamron lens, and that does set it apart from something like the Sony 70-300G. Now, the Tamron lens, when the hood is reversed and it is retracted, won't take up much space in your bag. It's only 5.8 inches long, which, you know, leads up to a joke about North American males, which I just don't need to make right now. And even though a lot of people might say the Sonys feel more well-built, honestly, I've never had any problems with these Tamron lenses and the way they're constructed. They're lightweight but solid. Everything turns nice and smooth. A lock on the zoom ring would have been nice to avoid lens creep, but they are weather sealed, so I have no problem with this lens standing up to abuse. Now, I know a lot of people are going to want to use this lens as an affordable sports, action, and wildlife lens, and I mean, absolutely go for it, but make no mistake, this is not a professional 2.8 zoom. We are getting 300 millimeters, but it's with an f6.3 maximum aperture. I mean, on a gray day like today, as much as I want to shoot at 100 ISO for these lens tests, I got to crank up the ISO, and you're going to have to do the same to get those fast shutter speeds. Autofocus on this lens is also fine, but it's not super fast. It's a stepping motor. It's not a fast drive like a linear motor. It'll give you smooth video transitions, but it's not quite going to push the lens as fast as you might want it to. And we like to talk about chromatic aberration when we're talking about lenses, and there's two kinds that we talk about: lateral CA and then longitudinal CA. Now, lateral chromatic aberration is where you get edges of contrast where you start to see some color fringing, and this lens does have a little bit of a magenta cast there in certain areas, but honestly, it's minor and it's something that software will easily take care of. Now, longitudinal chromatic aberration is where you get a color cast in out of focus areas in the background or out of focus areas in the foreground from your subject. And these can be very difficult to deal with. Luckily, on a slow lens like this, we're not really seeing that as an issue, so chromatic aberration is not going to keep you up at night. Now, the Tamron 70-300 is absolutely an affordable lens, so does that mean it's going to be sharp? Well, we compared it against its closest E-mount counterpart, the Sony 70-300G lens, which is honestly more than twice the price, and we know to be a very decent lens. I do want to point out the Tamron's a 4.5 to 6.3 aperture. The Sony is going to be a 4.5 to 5.6, so slight light advantage at the tele range. Anyways, let's talk about 70 millimeters first. The Tamron actually did very well. So first off, center sharpness, we noticed that wide open, the Tamron was maybe just ever so slightly sharper than the Sony. Once you stop the lens down to f8, they're basically on parity. However, we also found the corners on the Tamron to be sharper than the Sony. So that is a really nice result for Tamron. Now, what about at the 300 millimeter range where you're going to use a lens like this quite a bit? Well, it's a similar story insofar as in the center of the image, the Tamron wide open seems to be slightly sharper. Once you stop down, they're basically on par with each other. But corners are a little bit different here at 300 millimeters. The Sony 70-300 has better corners. And I think a big part of it is this. First off, let's just keep in mind, we don't have five lenses to sample. We've got one of each, okay? So there's going to be some variety there. But also, the Tamron has major distortion at 300 millimeters. You can see it in an example here. I mean, it's brutal. Now, you can correct this distortion in post, but it's going to do weird things to the corners. And so in that regard, I'd say at 300 millimeters, yeah, stick to the center on the Tamron. Now, when it comes to bokeh and its appearance on the Tamron 7300, first thing you'll notice, heavy cat's eye bokeh on any sort of specular highlights in the background. Now, in some situations, you can play with this. You can actually have fun with it, kind of get a swirly Petzval lens style look because it extends almost to the center of the frame wide open. But there'll be a lot of shots where it's going to look really distracting. You're not going to want that. You can get the bokeh to become more round as you go to f8, but really more around f10, honestly. And although you can still get quite soft backgrounds because of the extreme telephoto nature of this lens, you don't get a lot of light. You're going to have to really crank the ISO, and that might be an issue for you. The best thing about the Tamron 7300 is its low cost. You're getting a sharp lens which handles chromatic aberration very well. But let's keep in mind, although this is compact, it is still a fairly slow lens. And on a day like today, it was quite dark. That really limited what I could do with it. And I had to crank my ISO way higher than I wanted to. On top of that, I don't love the look of the bokeh, honestly, and that distortion at 300 millimeters is pretty extreme. But if you're looking for a great, versatile, compact, lightweight travel telephoto, this is gonna be fantastic for you, especially for the cost. And I think although the Sony G does have some characteristics that I do like, when you look at the price difference, this is probably gonna make a lot more sense to a lot more people. I hope this helps you decide if this is the right way for you to go. Please subscribe. We wanna see those numbers go up. Please help us out with that. Otherwise, thanks so much for joining us. Go to deepreview.com so you can check out the sample gallery on the Tamron 7300 RXD. And that's how you get the creepy street shots for sure.